Good morning, and can I welcome everybody to this, the sixth meeting of the Public Audit Committee in this session of Parliament. Before we start our business today, could I just remind everybody in the committee room that social distancing measures are still in place, and if you are moving around the room, entering or exiting the room, if you could wear a face covering. The first item we have of our business is to agree to take agenda item 3 in private. Is that agreed? It is agreed. Thank you. The principal item on the agenda today is a roundtable discussion on the subject which has been a recurring theme both for this committee and I think for Audit Scotland and for the wider Parliament and public, and that's the current state of child and adolescent mental health services in Scotland. It is a round table. I will ask members of the committee to ask questions in particular thematic areas, but I do want to stress that it is quite informal, and there is nothing to stop panellists asking questions of each other if that's felt to be useful. And if you do want to come in and speak, if you're in the room, indicate to myself or to the clerks. If you are joining us by video link, if you can use the chat box function and put an R in there, and then we'll take you as soon as we can. And again, for everybody, just a reminder, technically speaking, you don't have to activate your own microphone. That will be activated for you. And my final word is just to say that don't feel obliged to that you have to answer every question that's put. It may be, and you will see as the conversation develops, that there are particular areas that are most obviously applicable to some of you, and probably some less applicable. So come in whenever you want by indicating, and please feel free to have quite a freewheeling discussion, albeit that we've got to stick to a timetable. What I would like to do, first of all, is to invite everyone to introduce themselves. So I'm going to start with the MSPs who are on the committee, and then I shall come to the those of us joining us virtually before returning to the witnesses in the committee room. So, Sharon.
Good morning. I'm Sharon Dowie. I'm the MSP for South Scotland.
Hi, hello. I'm Willie Coffey. I'm the constituency member for Kilmarnock and Irvine Valley.
I'm Craig Hoy, the member for South of Scotland, and also, just for the record, also our party spokesman on mental health.
Colm Beattie, MSP for Midlothian North and Musselburgh constituency.
Can I turn to the people joining us via video link and perhaps start with you, Martin?
Hi, good morning. Martin Mackay, Unison's delegated representative for mental health, nursing and mental health. Thank you.
Hannah.
Morning, I'm Hannah Axon. I'm COSLA Policy Manager with Remit for Mental Health, and I'm here representing the COSLA Co-Chair, the Children and Young People's Mental Health and Wellbeing Joint Delivery Board.
Thank you. Donna.
Morning, everyone. I'm Donna Bell. I'm Director of Mental Wellbeing and Social Care at Scottish Government and Joint Chair of the Children and Young People's Mental Health and Wellbeing Delivery Board.
And Alex from Sam H.
Hi, good morning, everyone. Thanks for the opportunity this morning. My name is Alex Cumming, and I'm Assistant Director with Sam H, with Lead for Children and Young People Services.
And Alex from Grampian.
Good morning, everyone. I'm Alex Perry. I'm Service Manager for Child and Adolescent Mental Health Services in Grampian.
And Caroline.
Hi, I'm Caroline Amos, and I'm the Chair of the Mental Health and the Wellbeing Working Group.
Well, thank you very much, and thanks to all of you for taking part in this morning's roundtable discussion. As I said, I'm going to start with some questions from MSPs, but feel free to come in when you want to make a contribution or a point. And I'm going to begin with Sharon Dowie, who's got a question to get us underway. Sharon.
Good morning. And if I could maybe direct the first question to Mr. Boyle, the Auditor General. Audit Scotland's blog presents quite a bleak picture of performance in terms of access to child and adolescent mental health services, particularly given the significant investment that's been made. The comment was, but the picture today is similar to 2018 despite significant investment. Do we have any idea to the extent of this funding to be able to track this spend against outcomes?
And sorry, can I apologise for omitting to introduce our panellists that are actually in the committee room before my very eyes. Katrina, do you want to introduce yourself?
Good morning. I'm Katrina Morton. I'm a GP and here as Deputy Chair of RCGP Scotland. I'm the lead for policy there. And my day job is working as a GP in Craig Miller in Edinburgh. Thank you.
Thank you. And Stephen, before answering Sharon's question, would you like to introduce yourself?
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, everybody. I'm Stephen Boyle, the Auditor General for Scotland. In response to Ms. Dowie's question, and in terms of the investment that we've seen in response to the 2018 report, the blog that Audit Scotland produced in August references some progress, challenges that remain, and what's an extremely complex system. We also have all seen just the increasing demands that have come through from children and young people for mental health services, much of which has been exacerbated, of course, through the course of the pandemic. In direct response to your question, Ms. Dowie, whether we're yet seeing the impact of the investment in improved outcomes, we've not seen the, I suppose, two factors, really enough time or enough data yet to make the direct correlation between improving outcomes from the investment that's been made. We would recognise that the range of initiatives, new frameworks, new guidance that have taken place following the recommendations in the 2018 report, and that some of those are planned to be implemented between now and 2023. The one observation I think I would finish on is that by that point we'll be 5 years on from our original report, and what's already a very challenging environment, and all the more need for urgent progress to support Scotland's children and young people with their mental health.
Thank you.
Okay, and I'm sure that we will return to some of those themes. I wanted to begin by asking a question of the co-chairs of the delivery board, so perhaps taking Donna first and then Hannah could come in after that. One of the things that's in the blog, which was produced by Audit Scotland, spoke of, and I'll quote it directly, it said that there is a steep hill to climb and making it to the top will mean listening to and learning from the experiences of children and young people and their families. So my question to Donna and Hannah is, would you agree with that analysis? And what action are you taking through the delivery board to get us further up that steep hill?
Thanks, Convener. So it's always helpful to have contributions from Audit Scotland on our work. And I think they've identified very similar issues to those that the Joint Delivery Board has identified and has been working on for a number of months and in previous forums, years. And I think we're all agreed that change is still needed to make the necessary improvements for children and young people. And obviously the discussion that Stephen started to bring out there about the pandemic has had significant impact on children and young people, in addition to increased demand over recent years. I think in terms of the engagement with children and young people, it's something that the Joint Delivery Board has prioritised. We now have three young people who regularly participate in the Joint Delivery Board, and they are very able and very helpful contributors to that. So I think that is an excellent start. We also have a Children and Young People's Participation Officer who supports us in the Joint Delivery Board with engagement with young people about how services and support is working for them, and routinely feeds back to us at the board about those experiences and what we should be doing as that Joint Delivery Board to make the necessary change to support them better.
Just on that point, Donnie, can you confirm that they are members of, these young people are members of the Delivery Board?
Yes.
Yes, they are. Thank you.
Yes, they are.
And what about other family representatives? Are they also do they also have a voice at that table as well?
Yeah.
Yeah.
So we have a representative from the National Parent Forum as well, who joins us, who is a member and joins us routinely to feed in from a parental point of view. We realise the impact that the issues that might arise from children and young people having mental health concerns, and the impact that that has on their families. So I think the engagement with parents is also really, really important. And again, the colleague who comes from the National Parent Forum is a really helpful and engaged participant in the board.
Can I turn to Hannah Axon, just to give us a kind of local government perspective on that steep hill and where you see things? How far does the summit appear to be away from where you are?
Well, it's a steep hill. I think it's a challenge for all of us. I think from a board perspective, the scope of the work that's being undertaken is really encouraging, so that the board obviously has a focus on preventative work, but is looking at a set of deliverables that includes community support and crisis, and look at neurodevelopmental services and CAMS, and sort of the support required for our staff. So a really broad sort of cross-section of work being progressed, which I think is really, really encouraging. We have really good local government representation across that, though our colleagues from ADES, our educational psychologists, are really bringing the right people together to have those discussions and move up the hill. Going back to the children and young people's representation, that's happening, in all parts of the board's work. So we have the children and young people around the table at the board. We also have a set of youth engagement principles that we use across the full scope of the work. So there are task and finish groups looking at the delivery of each of the aspects of the work. And so we're thinking about how we involve children and young people in those steps, looking at how we involve them in a way that's really valuable and means that we can take that forward. And we also look at how we involve children and young people at a local level. So if we look, for instance, at the community support framework, there's an ask within the framework that there is consultation with children and young people. So it's being built in throughout the approach that the board is taking, both at the board and in the sort of resulting work at a local level.
Thank you. Can I just ask Alex Peary? I think you're a member of the Delivery Board as well, are you not? Do you have any perspective on the steep hill and where we are on it, and the engagement of young people and families?
Yes, I mean, I think as Hannah said, you know, we're working in a broad scope, and it is a steep hill, but we are definitely going in the right direction. I think a key thing that we have to do is listen to the voices of lived experience, you know, because they're the experts in their own lives. And certainly the task and finish group that I sponsor is the implementation of the National CAM Service specification and how we're developing a support programme. So we're certainly working with the participation officer to get the voices of lived experience to help shape the direction of travel. I think we have to be mindful in terms of how we engage children and young people. So a key learning point, you know, for the Joint Delivery Board is actually been when we're scheduling our meeting practical for them to join us, you know, so we really don't want to be meeting during school times, etc. But no, it is a steep hill to climb. I want to pick up on Anna's point as well about the community mental health and wellbeing supports framework. Certainly, my own experience in Grampian, we have done a lot of scoping and planning, but actually listening to the children and young people and their families in our local communities to find out what is needed. So that is why, you know, the approach that we're taking, Murray, is right for that local area. Aberdeenshire are doing something slightly different to meet the needs of their demographic, and again, it's the same for City. But certainly, it's a really good movement, and I think we're very, very engaged, and it's about doing with our children, young people and communities rather than doing to.
Thank you, and we are going to come on and look in a bit more detail at the Grampian experience, I think. Can I turn, though, back to Sharon Dowie, who I think has got a question on referrals. Sharon.
The Audit Scotland blog refers to a task force set up by the Scottish Government and COSLA in 2018, which concluded that earlier guidance and support was required for GPs, health visitors, school nurses and others. In 2021, what guidance and support exists for these professions? So what changes have happened? Could I direct that one, first of all, to Dr. Morton? And then maybe after that, if Mr. Mackay for Unison wants to come in, and if there's any other comments from anyone else.
Thank you very much. I suppose that was the question was about two things. One was about guidance and support, and the other was about referrals. Prior to this meeting, we contacted all our faculties in Scotland. The RCGP is very closely involved with them, so I've got feedback from GPs across Scotland, and particularly in Lothian, where I work. The feedback is actually very, very consistent, that there is just a big yawning gap. Obviously, GPs offer universal services and holistic care, and I think one of the advantages that we have is that we work very closely with our health visitors and we work closely with other members of the family, and it's often the whole family that are involved when a child has or an adolescent has a mental health problem. But the feeling still is that the bar for referrals is very, very high. GPs say, some of the feedback was GPs, and I include myself in this, will think three or four times, and I'm quoting there, before even considering a referral, and we have high levels of referral rejections. And I think the other thing about referrals is that we know how damaging it can sometimes be to the person referred and their family if they get a rejection, because they've often tried lots of other things before they get to us. Those things are often provided by schools, and that's more difficult when schools have been shut. And it's also been more difficult. It's also more difficult for children who are excluded from schools or who won't go to schools. So schools aren't open to everybody. So in terms of referrals, I mean, obviously, early on in the pandemic, we were generally asked not to refer people unless it was extremely urgent. That went across the board. And, we tried to stick to that. But the feedback I've got is that the waiting times are often 1 to 2 years. And that's also a deterrent to referral, because if you know that somebody's not going to be seen for such a long time and get treatment for such a long time, it means that it's difficult to say to a patient and their family, this is what's going to happen. And that essentially there are no tier two level services. I think the other thing that's been more difficult is that some of the third sector organisations that would be available to us during the and children and families during the pandemic have had to shut their doors completely, understandably, so they have been less accessible. So I read the 2018 Audit Commission report on rejected referrals, and I'm just going to say that the feedback that I've had and my own personal experience is that things don't feel very different from that. I think what has happened is that signposting has sometimes improved in some areas, but not all. But it really doesn't feel very different from that.
I have to say your comments are quite concerning, because the comments that you're coming out with just now are the exact same comments that I've just read in the report that was put out in 2019, which is obviously why we're trying to look at where the money's getting placed and whether we can actually measure what the outcomes are. Would Mr. Mackay like to come in now? Would you have any comments from Unison?
Yes, thank you very much. And reflecting on the discussion that we've just had, I think in terms of the blog and the board waiting times data from the previous years, I think it's interesting to note that apart from a few outliers, there's quite a lot of static data in there where there hasn't been a significant amount of change in the referrals. And I think it would have been interesting to have, and this ties into the discussion we've just had about the blocks in the system and waiting times that are experienced by others and on the committee today, if we had data about the whole time equivalent staffing group within CAM services across the board. I can certainly speak and for my own area. I'm from NHS Grampian and have worked alongside Alex for quite some time. And I know the changes that we made to the staffing cohort that have probably brought the regular increase of the improvements in NHS Grampian. And it would be interesting to see if we're looking about delivering services and equal access and equal quality of service across the country for the next 5, 10, 15, 20 years. I mean, and I've worked in mental health services for 30 years and I've been around CAM services for quite a significant part of that in different roles in terms of service redesign. And I know where we looked to plug the gaps to improve service. And it would be interesting to see if models can be replicated elsewhere. I mean, it's concerning in the data to see that some areas have dropped and if that's in terms of their deliverable data and if it's been influenced by staffing changes. And I think that would be, and that data will be there. I mean, each board has to, you know, has that data of what their staffing cohort is and what roles they have, at what band, etc. And I think that's one of the things that has to be looked at across the whole of Scotland. We need to look about, and that's particularly the comment by the colleague there about tier two services and access, how we can improve access at an earlier stage to improve outcomes for children and young adults, because a lot of that is down to who they can see and what that person can do and the actions that they can carry out in terms of their job role. And I think in from Unison's perspective, the broader and the more effective is the working team that you have to deliver a service with more skills, that improves the outcome for the service user, for the families, and it improves the service and the work experience for the members of staff as well. And that all goes to improve the entire experience. So it's, I think we need to look at more than just snapshots of some data and understand why the referral and the waiting times are a big priority, because it's something that you can latch onto and something that you can measure. But there's a lot of other impacts in there that I think is where we need to focus quite a lot of our attention to see where it can be improved and where those improvements have been effective elsewhere.
Okay, thank you. Is there anyone else that wants to?
Yeah, I think we've got a number of people indicating that they want to come in on this. I've got I'm going to take Alex Cumming from Sam H first, and after that I shall come to Alex Peary from NHS Grampian. But Alex Cumming, do you want to come in just now?
Yeah, thank you. Thanks all. So I think some of the stats that Ms Morton mentioned and within the blog report are absolutely heartbreaking, distressing for families. I think some of the comments that Hannah made, I suppose as our first input, are really, really key around this is about the breadth of work that's going on within the system. And I think overall we need to kind of shift the conversation from just CAMS to that whole kind of system change, I think is really, really important. I think the guidance that the programme boards have put out about the kind of CAMS criteria is really, really helpful, but there is still a total lack of understanding within the wider public about what CAMS is there for, you know, what it can support, etc. And I suppose probably understandably, you know, children, young people and their families still assume and still want CAMS to be the place that they can get support. You know, some of the campaigns and information over the last 18 months around kind of I Feels, Clear Ahead, are all supporting that kind of foundational level around mental health understanding, mental health awareness and having that kind of conversation. But I do think there's much more that we need to do collectively around you know, the wider public's understanding of what CAMHS does, and that actually CAMHS is not the only way and the only space to kind of get into, you know, supporting mental health. And I'm sure we'll come on to talk about, you know, the tier one and tier two services at some point this morning. I think maybe just going back to Katrina Morton's point around CAMHS referrals and GPs, etc. I mean, we've had just in the last month a number of conversations with kind of primary care, and GPs are still saying that they're really disappointed and are not understanding why some referrals are not accepted. But actually, I wonder, and again, this comes down to the system around whether, you know, those within primary care have the time and the space to be able to pull all the information together that's required for a referral within a 10-minute appointment. And also those barriers around some of the virtual appointments that are going on at the moment, is that something that's challenging for young people to kind of express their story and express their concerns, so that, you know, I suppose that GPs can then fully implement that referral. And that's maybe why there's a number of referrals and information that goes back to GPs for more information. So I think this is where, you know, some of our initial recommendations, previous audit report around that kind of multi-assessment process for referrals, I think maybe should be considered, and we really encourage government to do that. I think within a well-functioning system, we know that we wouldn't have any rejected referrals, but at the moment, I think our view would be, or our concern would be, is there a meaningful and is there personalised signposting from CAMHS? The CAMHS service works extremely hard to make sure communication is compassionate, but we know no matter what we do or what individuals do, when that letter lands on a young person's door, or, you know, again, it can be really, really distressing, and people can be quite despondent about it. So I think, you know, we don't know whether individuals are getting that additional support and accessing those additional services. That's why at SAMH we're funding an 18-month system change project in South Edinburgh. We're speaking to our colleagues at CAMHS, children, young people, families, all those that have been rejected from CAMHS, ensure that we kind of understand what, you know, how we make sure that the system, the information and the communication is appropriate. And the initial findings so far are very much suggesting that we know that families and young people need more information. They need a guided conversation, you know, following that CAMHS rejected referral, because, again, there's just such a range of services out there, and they don't know how to navigate that themselves, and we need to be able to provide them that support. I don't think that necessarily needs to be a job for a role for CAMHS, but it needs funded, and it's something we're certainly going to be looking at in the near future.
Thanks, Alec. I mean, GPs were mentioned a lot in that, so I will come to Alex Puri and to Donna Bell and to Hannah, but I do want to bring in Dr. Morton back in at this point.
Thank you. I mean, that all of that was said there does ring true with me in lots of ways, in the sense that it isn't all about waiting times, but I think when we refer people that we consider to be tier three or tier four, who then wait 1.5 to 2 years, not for tier four, obviously, then and we do get a feel for how long people are waiting because they come back to us repeatedly. So we do get a feel for all of that and the distress that in the meantime, and from throughout Scotland, those are the sorts of figures that people have been quoting me, just to come back to those waiting times. In terms of other support, that is absolutely key. And I think that having somebody follow up people who've been referred to CAMHS who are not seen would be so much more helpful than signposting, because often people have done all of that. They've done all the things to do with signposting. And some of the feedback we've had is that people are referred from CAMHS and referred to CAMHS and then told, well, go and see your school nurse, or go and see another third sector, see a third sector worker, where they're condition is far more serious and severe than could be managed by those systems. In terms of 10-minute appointments, we as you all know from elsewhere, GPs are working flat out just now, and it's very difficult if you're consulting with 30, 40 people a day to give time to individuals. But just talking personally, we would always see somebody who we would always see a child with mental health difficulties. I can't imagine not seeing them face to face. I referred somebody this summer who I saw several times face to face because it needed a lot of assessment. This person was in their teens. They were self-harming, they were anxious, they were depressed, they were no longer seeing their friends, they were isolating. I referred them and the referral was rejected. And I consider myself a very experienced mental health GP, and I felt that was an appropriate referral. And one of the other themes that we have from GPs is that there's nothing upstream. And, you know, what happens is that people then just deteriorate until they're at a point where they do have to be referred to CAMHS. And it would be fantastic to have that upstream working. And as I'm a member of the Scottish, I go to the Royal College of GPs, attends the Scottish Mental Health Partnership. We're one of 17 organisations. There are two medical colleges there, and we talk a lot about mental health provision in medical terms. But the other organisations talk about how we can change things now to help the future so that we don't need all this medical input. But I don't see that here. I see children and young people not getting help at a point where some of this could be improved or reversed earlier, so that they either struggle on by themselves or with facilities which can't really match the severity of their condition. But we're really, this is just building up difficulty for the future for our NHS, but also for those young people who will take these mental health problems into adulthood. And we know that happens. So it is, that's also what we need. I completely agree with that. And it's quite heartbreaking to see, because this affects not just the child, but the entire family. And many of these families, adults too, have mental health problems. It's not just the child. And we're concerned about safety. We know that alcohol and drug deaths have gone up markedly in Scotland. We know that domestic violence has gone up during COVID, and it's very hard to know sometimes what's happening to some children unless they present to us, or unless we happen to come across them in other ways. Thank you.
Thanks for that very powerful testimony from the front line. There were some other panellists who wanted to come in, so I am going to turn now to them. I'm conscious that time is marching on, but I do want to give an opportunity to come in on this point to, first of all, Alex Peary, and then I shall ask the two co-chairs of the delivery board to come in. But if Alex Peary, you want to come in first.
Thank you. I just wanted to touch base on some of the things that we're doing in Grampian to support the referral process from GPs to CAMHS. So we have published quite detailed referral guidance, which is available to our GPs on our GP portal on the NHS Grampian intranet. Appreciate that our GPs as well are incredibly busy, as Dr. Morton has highlighted, and are doing maybe 30 to 40 consultations a day. So we've done things like, you know, visual aids around, you know, what the referral process is and what is maybe an appropriate referral. We're also trying to look across our system in Grampian about how we raise awareness of the tier two services that are being developed via the community mental health and wellbeing supports framework. Within Grampian CAMHS, we use a choice and partnership approach. So where a child or young person is referred to CAMHS, and we take them for an initial assessment and appointment, you know, it's very much looking at the assets and the options available to the young person. It's their choice whether or not they carry on in CAMHS. Sometimes CAMHS is not appropriate for them, so we will signpost them, but we actually write that to our GPs so that they're aware. Certainly we've also attended meetings with our GP subcommittee to see how we can maybe improve the interface between CAMHS and GPs. We've also aligned our clinical teams into satellite teams so that they're more closely linked to GP practices. Martin picked up earlier around some of the staffing challenges. So, for example, we know we've got a national shortage of psychiatrists. What we're doing in Grampian is we're looking at other types of staff. So, for example, we're working to increase our nurse prescribers as well, which should help with patient flow. I'm happy to say that the current waiting time to first appointment in for CAMHS in Grampian is 6 weeks. Very sad to hear that in some areas it's 1 to 2 years, but along with the Joint Delivery Board, we're looking to develop a support programme to help other CAMHS services move forward. And I think Alex from SAMH made a really good point. I think CAMHS services across the board need to get better in terms of publicising what we do and actually what CAMHS is for. And certainly that's some of the things that we're looking to do in Grampian around Facebook and other options for social media. I just wanted to highlight some of those things.
Thanks very much indeed, Alex. And I'm going to turn to Donna. And forgive me, Hannah, I gave you the elevated title of co-chair of the delivery board, which I know you are not. You're here representing COSLA and the voice of local government on that delivery board. So, but can I ask Donna to give us her observations?
Yeah, thank you, convener. And I think colleagues have covered quite a lot of the issues I would raise already. It is not common for people to wait for 2 years, but obviously where that happens, we absolutely need to improve it. And I think the position, and Alex Perry has highlighted the arrangements that are in place for really much CAM's point of view. And we know that, for example, in Fife, there are arrangements in place for primary care mental health workers who meet with children and young people within 2 weeks. So the position, I think, is very variable across the country. And I think the other issues around GP referral, I think the points are well made by Alex Cummings. The referral criteria were agreed with the College of GPs, so obviously we're always happy to discuss that. And if there is a communications issue or if there are other matters that we need to follow up on there, you know, we're always happy to do that. I think the other point that I would raise, that for particularly long waits, we have seen issues with neurodevelopmental referrals, which are often very complex. And we recently published a neurodevelopmental specification just at the beginning of September, and some additional funding to support that of around 5.25 million. So I think we're very aware that for particularly complex cases, there's more action to be taken. I think the points, again, that Alex Cummings made about the CAMS services, and Alex Perry also made these about CAMS services being able to signpost or indeed refer children and young people to other suitable community services, and the points about breadth are really, really important, because one of the key things, and Hannah mentioned this right at the very beginning, is that we're clear, and I think everybody in the sector is clear, that CAMS isn't suitable for everyone, but we need to have suitable support in place. And certainly, and this might be what Hannah is about to talk about, is the additional support that we are putting in place in the community. Just on the accessibility of CAMS, we know that CAMS is the second highest user of Near Me. Young people are very comfortable with digital appointments. And that, I think, has been a really, really important development over the course of the pandemic. And we're really keen to see that carry on, because that obviously improves accessibility, it improves engagement. And we're also seeing GPs beginning to refer to those community supports that we are putting in place locally. So it's early days there, but certainly I think it's a promising shift. So we know, for example, that there have been over 350 referrals from health professionals direct to community services in the past few months. Thank you.
Thank you. Hannah, do you want to come in?
Yeah, I think the points about community services have been made. I think another one that I'd go back to what Alex had said about the need for systems change, but also cultural change and awareness. And I think at a local level, we have a huge task around the promotion of these services. So they have significant amount of funding, so £15 million gone to community-based support. and to be in place from January of this year. So services are still quite young, and there's a lot of awareness raising to do with parents to make sure they're aware that that's an alternative, with children and young people to make sure they're aware that's an alternative, because a lot of them are self-referral. I'm aware, for example, of CLACS having done an immense amount of work with cinema advertising, with their sports staff going out doing lots of promotion work with the children and young people and broader. So I think it's something we're really aware that needs done and that is actively being done at a local level. It's also something we're looking at the board. So there's a task and finish group within the board looking at communication and across the system. And so GPs is an area that we're certainly looking at working with in terms of information and making sure we can support that join up.
Thank you. Sorry, Hannah, could you clarify which local, were you referring to a particular local authority that was using cinema advertising?
Clackmannanshire.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you. Look, I want to move on now to another area. And one of the people that we haven't heard from so far is Caroline Amos, who's the chair of the Mental Health in Schools Working Group, which was set up by the Scottish Government. So, Caroline, I mean, we understand the group has recently produced an online training resource. And the first thing I wanted to just ask you was the extent to which there has been take up of that and how much engagement there has been with it. Welcome.
OK, so that's thanks. That's part of the next step, our next stage of our work. So it has been monitored. So the data has been gathered in relation to how many people are engaging with it. And it's a resource that can be used by everybody. It's not just for school staff. And so we are the next step for us as a working group is to look at that data and also to have some qualitative conversations with people who use the resource and are engaging with it and have volunteered to participate in that evaluation. So at this point, we don't have that specific data. So at the moment, we're in it's about ensuring that as many people as possible are aware that it exists and have access to it.
Thanks. I mean, two questions. One is, do you think when the data is available, you will publish it and put it into the public domain? And secondly, have you picked up any, at this early stage, any anecdotal evidence of the extent to which the package is going down well or is being taken up or not?
It's highly accessible. It's easy to navigate. It has very useful information on it. It has been produced and used kind of consultation with young people and families. So it is, I think, that first point that we were debating in that how are we involving the young people who have the kind of lived experience? And so anecdotally, yes, people are engaging with it because it's accessible and easy. Teachers in particular have become very used now to online professional learning throughout this pandemic. So it's a time and place of their choosing to engage in this professional learning. And it's also, I suppose, anecdotally, it's the kind of resource you can pick up, leave and then come back to engage with. It's not something you have to sit with for an entire period of time. I don't think there'll be any issue with publishing the data once we have it. I think it will be useful because it's one of the absolute actions of the working group going forward is to make sure that the resources that we have produced are used and have an impact on those that we're expecting them to have an impact on.
And Caroline, can I just check, is this aimed at all school staff or is it just teaching staff?
No, it is aimed at all school staff. In fact, it can be accessed by members of the public too, by parents too. So it's not just open to those groups or those professionals, but it is aimed at all school staff.
Thank you. I know Alex Cumming from SAMH wants to come in on this point as well. So Alex, I'll welcome you back in.
Thanks. And thanks, Caroline. And just to say that we were absolutely delighted when obviously earlier on in the summer when the information and the new training for all school staff was distributed right across the board. Just in relation, might be helpful in relation to statistics. We also a couple of years ago produced some training which was specifically for teachers, e-learning and for school staff. And in the first month of lockdown, that was accessed 4,000 times. So I've got absolutely no doubt that the new training that has been kind of produced by the Mental Health and Schools group will be really, really well used. I suppose a bit of feedback that we had from our previous training was that obviously the youth work sector was kind of key as part of that and supporting. And then obviously I know part of the committee papers was around that obviously universal support for practitioners. So we are actually just about to launch a specific e-learning for youth workers around mental health as well. Very, very much foundational. And then hopefully once they've had an opportunity to complete that, they'll maybe see the additional training that Caroline and the team have produced as the next step. I think with all of this though, and particularly knowing a lot of the work that's going on in the schools at the moment, it's very much around how leadership within the schools can allow staff the capacity to be able to access these things, because I know everyone, whether it be school, GPs, everyone, we're all at absolute capacity at the moment. So that's going to be a huge challenge, but I'm sure all the leadership across the schools in Scotland will be working hard to do that for teachers and practitioners.
Thank you, Alex. Can I just swiftly go back to Caroline Amos? There's been quite a lot of a push for counselling services to be available to secondary schools in particular. And I think some data came out about that, some analysis of that came out fairly recently. But I just wondered from your perspective, how you think that rollout of counselling services is going on the ground, either from a kind of Scotland-wide or a North Ayrshire perspective?
Yeah, so this is not part of my remit, and it's not part of the working group as such. So within North Ayrshire, which is where my day job is, we do have counsellors. We have had them since the Scottish Attainment Challenge was introduced. It was part of our Attainment Challenge commitment, one of our work streams. So we have introduced them, and we've continued, and I'm talking about North Ayrshire in particular, we've continued to engage with counselling services and increase them across sectors. And also as part of that community mental health and wellbeing, we've introduced further counselling service as a result of that to support some of our younger young people. So it has been a positive introduction for us in North Ayrshire, and there's lots of data in North Ayrshire in support of that introduction and the impact that it's had on our young people, as we have to obviously report through to the Scottish Government for the Scottish Attainment Challenge. So, but I can't speak widely about counselling services across Scotland.
Well, because Donna, I presume the delivery board has got some oversight of counselling services, so I don't know whether you can answer that question more directly.
Thanks, Convener. So we know, and Hannah will be able to contribute to this as well, but we know that all our local authority partners have confirmed that access to counselling support services is now available right across Scotland. We don't have specific data on numbers of appointments and outcomes as yet, and Hannah might be able to give a bit more feedback on that. But certainly, we have a colleague from Scottish Government Learning Directorate who's also a member of the board, and their feedback is that certainly school counselling has been very well received, uptake has been very good, and also that the teaching staff and other school staff welcome this as an additional intervention to provide I suppose additional support on top of pastoral care. So I'm not sure actually if Hannah would want to. I know that I shouldn't be dropping my colleagues, and it might be that Hannah will want to say a bit more.
Donna, I said at the start of the session that you can ask each other questions. Yeah. It's not just a matter of fielding questions from members of the Scottish Parliament. Hannah, we're over to you. Do you have anything you want to come in?
I think, as Donna said, that we have access to school counselling in all local authorities at this stage, and we've had the first round of reporting on it, which has generated the data I think the committee has seen. So we're looking at shy of 10,000 children and young people having access to counselling at this point. The outcomes data that they report, where children report positive outcomes, I'd have to look at the data to come back to you on a figure, but I think that is encouraging. But I think it's also really early days looking at sort of the first round of reports. What is interesting, I think, is that we're beginning to see some trends we believe coming out of that data, where we have more young women, more girls accessing counselling than boys. So something to consider there, and some really interesting thinking to do around how we align our community services and support, perhaps where school counselling isn't the option that people are ready for or would choose. So early days, but interesting learning, and I think positive to this point.
Thank you. I think that's useful to put that on the record. My final question for now is really to Alex at Sam H, and that's really about, I suppose my starting point is, this is Challenge Poverty Week, isn't it? And we know from the Audit Scotland report in 2018 that if you are living in a low-income household, you are three times more likely as a child to suffer mental health problems than if you are living in a more affluent household. So there is an issue there of poverty and how that has an effect on mental health, self-esteem, self-harming, anxiety, stress, depression, and so on, are going to be accentuated if you are being brought up in poverty. Educational performance will be affected, as well as overall life chances. So my question to Alex from Sam H is enough being done to recognise the scale of that challenge and the inequality that produces?
Thank you, Convener. So I think, and we've been having conversations just this week, that inequalities, or you know, the inequality of accessing services is almost our number one priority kind of going forward. I think there's been a couple of comments around, you know, virtual access and use of Near Me, and I think we've absolutely got to continue to use that. That has been helped improvement and has helped access to services. But we still know that it's probably those families, probably still those communities with slightly greater resources that are accessing the services, or kind of driving you know, forward towards accessing those services. So whatever happens, you know, I think we need to have services that are community-based, that are there, that are accessible. In some, you know, in some parts of Scotland, I know it's not possible everywhere, but you know, you're talking about your 20-minute city. So access, at, you know, in some places, more urban areas, obviously, you know, we want to make sure that there's those things available 20 minutes from your doorstep. I know that's probably not possible, Alex and Grampian and etc. But you know, I think that's absolutely key and absolutely critical for anything going forward, particularly around mental health services. Of course, we could all could be and should be doing more, but I certainly don't think it's not a focus of all the colleagues around the room. I wouldn't say, but it's something that we definitely need more of a focus on.
Thank you, and I'm going to invite Katrina Morton. I mean, Katrina, you work in a relatively a deprived part of the city of Edinburgh. That's where your practice is. Mm-hmm. I don't know whether you've got any reflections on the impact of poverty and inequality on the mental health of the people that you see?
Yes, I think it's difficult to sum up very quickly. We know that poverty has a huge effect on mental health, on alcohol, drug addiction, well-being. And prior to the pandemic, we consulted with about 11% of our population every week. So that was our consultation rate. And around half of those consultations were largely to do with mental health. That's gone up. And we did have a quieter time at the height of the pandemic, but people with mental health problems are in distress. We're seeing people who've never been mentally ill before presenting with new mental illness, and people who are already mentally ill a lot worse. I think one thing that has helped us, and Edinburgh HSCP has been good at identifying the most deprived practices in Edinburgh and making sure that they're prioritised for mental health nurses. So we have mental health nurses in our practice, and that's something the college is part of the new GP contract, but it's something the college has asked for more generally. But there are very few practices that have that, and that is just transforming, because often we're the first port of call, but we also know other members of the family. And I think it's extremely helpful for children's health as well. But what we can't do is take on work that other agencies should do. So I think the other thing is I saw the rejection rate for referrals from deprived areas, and I would argue that those people probably need to have a lower bar because there's often a lot going on in that family that may not always be apparent initially. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. I am going to try and move the conversation on a little bit, and I want to invite Craig Hoy to ask a number of questions. Craig.
Thank you, Convener. One is for the Auditor General. First and foremost, really just a clarification, really. You note in the blog at point 8 that following referrals to CAMHS looks like the only one bright spot. I was slightly surprised by the fact that even the number was down, but I note that you add the caveat that there's probably a number of extenuating circumstances. Because just to compare that with a report I read recently from the Royal College of Psychiatrists that pointed to data from Public Health Scotland that said that in the second quarter of this year there were 10,193 referrals to CAMHS, which was the highest ever, and now equates to 1 in 100. So I was just wondering if you've got any update on that data to point to the fact that maybe that may have been a mirage almost.
Yeah, good morning, Mr. Lloyd. I think you're right. I think there is a pandemic-orientated aberration in some of those stats. I think effectively what's been highlighted by Dr. Morton in our previous contribution is that referrals and access to services more generally would have fallen right at the height of the pandemic, and we think that's what's informing these statistics. What we don't yet have is validated data to confirm that that's the case, but I think what I'm probably hearing over the course of this morning's conversation is that that's probably the circumstances that led to the drop that we reported in the blog. Nonetheless, clearly, you know, very significant factors behind the rates of referrals. But also, I think the point that we're making more widely is that emerging but yet incomplete data around what happens to referrals to, you know, children and young people who are engaged in the system, who are rejected, and then the extent of wait times that we sought to highlight through the blog.
So just assuming that we're broadly in a position where maybe we do have the highest level of referrals, what we also seem to have is the highest ever level of rejected referrals. And obviously in the 2018 report, I think Sam H and NHS Information Services Division came forward with 29 recommendations that were, I think, all accepted by the Scottish Government as a way of trying to bring down those rejected referrals. And perhaps the next question, maybe for Hannah and Donna, and then perhaps Alex from Sam H, is how effective do you think the Government has been in implementing those 29 recommendations? And also, what level of comfort or discomfort do you presently have with the overall level of rejected referrals? Is there a level that you would be comfortable with because you think that that would not be the right route for those individuals? So is it, if that 25%, would you be comfortable with 10% for example? Perhaps Hannah, I think, is first up.
I'm not sure that that's gone off as it has. I think we want a minimal in terms of rejected referrals. Once we have our community services are up and established, the principle would be that young people were caught earlier, they got the support they need before a CAMHS referral was required. But I don't know that anyone has determined what an ideal level within the system would be. And I think I'd defer the question to Donna around the Scottish Government actions around the recommendations.
Donna, do you want to come in on that?
Yes, thanks, Convener, happy to. We have made some significant progress on the 29 actions set out, and very happy to give the committee a breakdown of the actions taken against the 29. I think some of those have now been superseded by actions taken and commitments made, but very happy to provide that cross-reference for the committee if that would be a helpful thing to do. I think on the point around what would be an acceptable level of rejections, that's a really difficult question to answer. I suppose, ideally, there wouldn't be any at all. But there will always undoubtedly be, and it may be useful actually to ask the clinicians about this, you know, differing clinical opinions about what's needed. I suppose the important thing there, and we've talked about this quite a lot already, is that appropriate support is in place for the people who aren't accepted by CAMHS. So I think I would probably align quite closely with Hannah on saying minimal and not want to commit to a percentage there.
Do any of the other panel members want to come in on that point, or if not, yes, Dr. Morton.
Thank you. So I realise I've spoken quite a bit. Just coming back to referrals, I think the ideal would be virtually none. And I think if you've got a congruence of understanding between the GP's referral and CAMHS, then that should be achievable. I think part of the problem now is that it was mentioned earlier about the referral criteria, and I think we understand the referral criteria. It's just that, well, we believe we understand them, but we refer people that we believe are in tier three who are then rejected. And I think that's what's difficult. But alternatives to admission make, alternatives to referral does make a difference. If you've got nowhere else to refer for somebody who's got very significant and enduring problems, then it ends up being a CAMHS referral if there feels like there's nothing else. And I've been very encouraged to hear about the community developments that we've been talking about. I also work as a referrals advisor for NHS Lothian, and I know there's lots of things that can be done to help that mutual understanding so that you get the right person to the right place. But I think the problem here is often there isn't a right other place for that person. And the other thing I would say is that it has been encouraging hearing all this, and I think it is very difficult for GPs to keep up with rapid systems change. So third sector organisations and access to them are changing all the time. It is almost a full-time job trying to keep up with that. And it's also how we inform GPs and keep GPs live to that, those new possibilities that are opening up. And I am also going to say that GPs are sympathetic to CAMHS. I mean, what I said earlier may have sounded quite stark, but it's very difficult emotional work, helping manage and listen and speak to people, children and adolescents in distress. And the GP view is there's just a capacity issue, and that's often what it comes down to. Thank you.
Thank you. I think Alex Cumming also wants to come in on this point as well. So, Alec, I'll bring you in.
Thank you. And just to kind of respond directly to Mr. Hoy's kind of request or query, I think Dr. Morton's right there, just in relation to the kind of community-based services, just to respond quickly to that point. You know, I think the community-based services and the sustaining of those services, we know that some of the procurement process have only just come to an end there. We don't know the impact. But it's really important for the link workers within GP practices, the mental health nurses, as Dr. Morton has mentioned, are really super aware of everything that's going on locally, so that they can then upskill the rest of the staff within the practice, and make sure that again that might provide the information and allow a reduction of that kind of referral rate as well. I think in a well functioning system, ideally there'd be no rejected referrals, but appreciate for all of us that the term rejected referral is quite emotive. It's quite distressing, and I think in direct response to our CAMHS audit, one of the recommendations was that term should not be changed, and we should continue to use that term until we have appropriate systems in place, so that we know that individuals are genuinely being redirected rather than necessarily just being signposted. And I think from what we see, again, it's still very much a signposting, and we know that young people are not accessing those services in the community, or they don't know how to access some of those services. So I'd really encourage the Scottish Government to, maintain the rejected referrals until we feel, we're starting to get all those building blocks, and there's a lot of really, really positive stories out there. But until we have everything fully in place, fully implemented, I would encourage that we continue the rejected referral terminology. And I really welcome, you know, Donna's comments around an update on the, you know, the 29 recommendations and where we think things have been superseded. And we know, as I said, there's been a phenomenal amount of work, you know, through the pandemic and prior to that as well. But I think probably in direct response to Mr. Hoy's question, I think we still have a long way to go, as I suppose the Audit Scotland blog has kind of indicated.
I think just one final question, perhaps for Alex, coming again. Obviously, the government has made £40 million available for CAMS improvement work based upon the CAMS service specification to try and achieve a national standard of service. And I was just wondering, the referrals pathway was one of the key issues, I think, that was identified in those 29 recommendations. What are the most significant gaps that need to be addressed in the referrals pathway, in your view, Alex?
Yeah, thank you. I think the, you know, going back to our original recommendations, we want a pathway or a system that removes any inefficiencies. You know, as Dr. Morris has mentioned, a number of GPs are referring because they genuinely feel that it meets their criteria, but things are rejected, or there's, you know, I know that some of our working with colleagues from CAMS, they feel there's bits of information missing. So again, that's all kind of clogging up the system. Though, as part of our, you know, recommendations, we did suggest, you know, a multi-agency approach to kind of making sure that we're getting input at an early stage. And I know that in some CAM services, you know, they have kind of set up, opportunities for kind of primary care to actually meet and have quick discussions, you know, around particular complex cases and see whether referrals are appropriate. But we know, again, that just kind of comes down to capacity. But for us, I think we'd still be advocating that multi-agency approach for referral. And then, you know, if there is an opportunity and it's very clear that tier one or tier two services are appropriate, who's that navigator, who's that link worker that can support the young people and the families to kind of access those services so that, you know, hopefully we have a positive outcome, and young people and families are not feeling let down. I think a lot of it is around expectations of the system and within the system. And I think we need to, all these things, as I said, these building blocks are there, but not necessarily fully implemented.
Okay, thank you very much. Again, I want to just try and nudge things on a little bit, and we've got a number of questions I know that Willie Coffey wants to ask, so I'll invite Willie to ask those questions. Over to you, Will.
Thanks very much, convener, and good morning, everyone. I wonder if I could perhaps start with Donna. It's in the area of the 18-week standard, Donna, and it's partly to clarify what it actually means for me and for constituents whom I represent. When does the clock start ticking on the 18-week standard? Is it at the point where a family has a meeting with someone to then get a meeting with CAMS? Is it that the 18-week that we're targeting?
So referral is made to CAMS, I suppose the clock begins to tick at that point. I suppose the other thing, and Alex Perry may want to add to this as well, that's not the only thing that might happen. I think this is one of the points that we've been trying to make here about breadth. There are a range of other things that might happen for children and young people whilst they are waiting. But I would probably bring in Alex on the specifics around the when the clock starts ticking and the process as the expert on the CAMS spec and implementation.
Which Alex was it?
Sorry, Alex Perry.
Alex
Perry from Grampian.
Alex, just on this, the standard says treatment should start within 18 weeks, but some parents say to me, well, I got a meeting within 18 weeks, but a meeting isn't treatment. What constitutes treatment?
So in Grampian, treatment will be it's clinical judgment when treatment would start. So within Grampian CAMS, we work in the choice and partnership approach. So the initial assessment appointment could be the first clinical assessment and possibly started treatment, you know, at which point, you know, the clinical information is given, advice, you know, and I suppose access to resources in the meantime while they're waiting for their next appointment with their allocated clinician, be that a psychologist, a nurse, etc. So it's very, very much on a case-by-case individual basis in terms of what's relevant to that child or young person. So certainly within Grampian, we used to stop the clock at our second appointment. But when we dug a bit deeper and we started, you know, looking at the clinical processes and those appointments, in some cases we were actually finding that treatment for the child or young person started at the first appointment where they're agreeing, you know, what the next steps is, what their care plan is. For some children, young people and their families, they need to do a bit of homework in preparation for their next appointment, etc. So it is very, very much an individual thing. But for us, I would say, you know, it's really guided by the clinician, the child and young person and their family when that treatment starts. It's a very, very individualised approach. And certainly, as I mentioned earlier, within Grampian, our waits to first appointment from point of referral is 6 weeks. And that could be the start of treatment depending on the circumstances of that individual child or young person.
Yeah, that's really interesting. I've read the comment in the papers, Alex, about Grampian, which is really impressive, but it says seen within, right? The average of 6 weeks. Parents say to me, being seen isn't necessarily the same as treatment, so I was really hoping to get some kind of clarification or sense around the panel about what exactly we mean by treatment, because some parents ask me that having a meeting wasn't treatment and they're still hoping and waiting for treatment along the line. So there's a little bit of confusion there. And does that possibly explain the discrepancy we're hearing today? Dr. Morton said, well, it can be 1 to 2 years, and then there's Grampian saying a six weeks average. Are we all talking about the same thing for some treatment to happen for a young person? Is it the same thing we're talking about? Or on the one hand, are we talking about having a meeting, and on the other hand, having some kind of treatment defined for a young person? Maybe Donna could help and come back in on that, please.
Yeah, so treatment is defined in the National Data Definition Standards for CAMHS. It's published by PHS. And I suppose it's interesting what Alex, I'll use your full name there, says, though, about what people feel constitutes treatment. It might actually, as a clinician, be more appropriate for her to say a wee bit more about suppose a clinical perspective on what treatment is and what parents might feel, because I think that's what you're trying to get at, Mr. Coffey. Is that fair?
Yep. So it's why is there such a discrepancy then? If we're all talking about the same thing, convener, why is there such a discrepancy still across Scotland 3 years on from the previous Audit Scotland and Audit Committee's report on this, where we're seeing families waiting 1 to 2 years in some part of Scotland and we're turning it around within 6 weeks in another part of Scotland? What on earth is going on there, and what can we be doing to try and bring that into line, perhaps with the Grampian experience? Donna.
I don't think Alex has been put on the spot by Donna. I think Alex has indicated in the chat box that she wants to come back in. So I am going to ask Alex Piri from NHS Grampian to come in and respond from your perspective to Willie's questions here. And I might bring Martin Mackay in as well while I'm at it. But anyway, I'll bring in Alex first of all.
Thank you. I think the first thing to highlight is that children and young people referred to CAMHS can be referred for a range of different reasons. So, for example, anxiety, a neurodevelopmental assessment, depression, eating disorders, etc. So the actual type of treatment really does depend on, you know, what that particular mental health problem is for that individual child or young person. So, for example, the treatment plan might be a psychological therapy, or depending on the circumstances, you know, that there could be a need to start a young person in medication. So I think that's what I was getting at around, possibly there is something there around expectations as well. You know, I am seeing an increase in parental expectations, you know, around, you know, how quickly can you fix my child, you know, can you give them medication, etc. You know, I think we have to bear in mind that our parents have been through a very difficult time during the pandemic as well, and, you know, that they are managing the risk and the challenges with their own child's mental health problem. So really, the treatment is defined based on the reason for referral and actually what's going on for that individual child or young person. It could be a psychological therapy, it could be medication, it could actually be a group, etc. You know, so that's what I mean when I say it's very much defined on an individualised basis. There's not a one-size-fits-all because we're dealing with people at the end of the day.
My final point on it, I suppose, convener, is that the Auditor General's blog there in point 7 tells us that people waiting more than a year for the treatment has trebled in the last 12 months, and that's quite a worry. But you do see it could be a marker of the pandemic, Auditor General, but I still feel that that's a bit inconsistent with the Grampian experience, and I'm not entirely certain I understand why it's such a discrepancy that we have to. Probably merits further investigation when the committee has time, convener. But could anyone offer a reason why there should be such a difference between the great performance in Grampian and elsewhere in Scotland if that trend is up, as the Auditor General says? Stephen, could you offer a possible explanation at all?
I think, Mr. Coffey, I'm probably best to defer to the experts and the clinicians around the table for their insight. I think what we sought to do through the blog is to raise the profile again of children and young people's mental health, and also, as we signal at the end of the report, that this isn't the end of our interest in it, and it's our intention, along with the Accounts Commission, to undertake some further audit work in this. As the committee, I'm sure, will be interested, we're also very keen to follow through on Donna's contribution about the progress against the original recommendations. But in terms of the analysis between the Grampian experience and the rest of Scotland, extremely interested about the factors that have led to that, and remains our intention to undertake further audit work in this area.
Okay, I'll probably leave it at that, convener, and allow other colleagues to come in. But thank you to the panel for trying to answer those queries from me.
Thank you. I do have, Willie, you'll be delighted to hear, I've got a couple of participants that do want to give a brief, I think, contribution on the questions that you're asking. I know Alex Peary wants to come back in again. I think that's for the third time in this little session. But I do want to invite Martin Mackay, because we've spoken quite a bit about the NHS Grampian experience and as well as the on the ground how the service is delivered and how it's navigated. So I'm going to invite Martin, if you want to come in, just to reflect on that, and then I shall bring in Alex, and I think Donna wanted to come back in briefly as well. But Martin, over to you.
Thanks, convener. Yeah, I mean, Mr. Coffey's point's well made, and I think the discussions that were had earlier by colleagues around education and communication are important, because it's that understanding. I mean, as a mental health nurse, a 30-year service, the understanding of what are you doing for me, or what you're going to do for me, or what you're going to do for my family member, is difficult in our role, because it's not a job where you take an x-ray and show someone where it's broken. And that's always been, sometimes that's the first barrier you have to get through. And I think it's the Mr. Coffey's point. If he is unclear working around these levels about what that, then the individual and their family are going to be unclear if it's first contact as well. So in my lead up to this committee, I spoke to colleagues from our education sector, and reflecting on some of the discussions earlier about the training aspects, I mean, there are some good examples out there of how our staff members within education are being assisted and trained to understand and support children in their care. Because when you think about it, apart from their own family, That's where the children and young adults are going to spend most of their time. It's in education, hopefully, and good work done to keep them in education. So the staff in there and the information that they have and the support that they can give to the children and young adults they're supporting and their families is vital as well. And I think some of the points to go back that Alex Cumminson made earlier, I'm very interested in the project he's speaking about the how to support projected referrals, because my education colleagues had indicated to me that one of their great concerns was how to support children when a referral has been rejected and the impact that it has on the child and their families and the impact that it has on staff to try and support them through that if they have to go in for another referral again and again and again. So I think those supports, just the primary care aspects and how we deliver them are important. As I said at the outset of the meeting, there's a scope here, and I think Mr. Coffey spoke about the investment, and others have mentioned that there's a scope here to build new roles that can plug those gaps. Your invitation for me to come in, my experience of working in the service review of the CAM service in Grampian, which Alex will remember as well as I do, it was a very long and complicated and complex review, but we believe, and I think the data shows that it's delivered results. It's always my and my role as, you know, working in service redesign within NHS Grampian as a staff side partnership rep, I always look at the gaps in service and the risks and where the negative aspects are, because you can't ignore them, because they inform you where the service isn't working. And I think I've had this discussion within Grampian in recent weeks in terms of the funding. And I think when we look at it, it's not a negative approach. It's a sensible, and it's going to deliver information of where you need to improve your service. As I said, I've worked in adult mental health for over 20 years, and in that time, my ward was the adult ward that held the remit for CAMHS admissions at Tier 4. And it's always a hard, hard thing to have children, young adults admitted into adult wards. So it was always my view of how did we get there and how could we have stopped that. So looking at other roles that would improve the connections and fill the gaps between other parts of service to have earlier support and earlier impact on mental health of children and young adults, I think is the important thing for us to look at the next 5, 10, 15, 20 years. Because as my GP colleagues stated, that if we don't have early intervention and effective early intervention, this will continue into adult life. And it's those transition points, I think, is a very, very important areas that we need to look at within looking at the whole service across Scotland. Because the gaps and the points where things fall down and where people drop through the net is where we have to focus on improvement. Because if we keep doing the same thing and throwing money at the same thing, we're going to get the same results. We don't have the amount of clinicians that we need. We can't train them quick enough, and we don't get them into service quick enough. So we need to look at building other roles and other effective roles that are going to improve the outcomes for the people that access this service. And it is not, I think it's sensible to look at where we fail, because that's where we need to improve.
Yeah, thanks Martin. I know that there were several other panellists wanting to come in on this point, but I think you're all likely to be in the scope of some of the questions that Colin Beattie is about to ask. So don't feel that you need to strictly answer the question which Colin asks only if you want to go back and make any points that you think were important to make in that conversation with Willie about how things are working on the ground. But Colin, over to you.
Thank you, Convener. Or in general, you've so far escaped a bit of questioning here, so I've got a couple of questions for you. In paragraph 7, as been pointed out, the number waiting for treatment has trebled over the last 12 months. Yet at the same time, the number of referrals to CAMHS have gone down by 17%. How do you equate these figures?
So I think it's probably two things, Mr. Beattie, and partly I touched on to the response to Mr. Hoy. I think we rightly caveat the drop in referrals, I think, with the probably people's appetite and access to services during the height of the pandemic. And I think we make reference to school closures and acknowledging all that Dr. Morton has said about the, you know, the ongoing work of GPs, about the extent to which children and young people were able to access GP services, recognising fairly that, you know, Near Me stepped in and increased significantly during the course of the pandemic. So we think that's a key component of it. But then also about the trebling of the wait times is probably another component of the pandemic, the extent to which all the factors we've heard about already this morning about the pandemic already exacerbating mental health in children and young people, the difficult circumstances that Scotland's children and young people, particularly those from our more deprived communities, would have found in the home about their access to education, concerns with the adults in the home about their mental health, and all of those factors being that groundswell of demand for services and the ability with which to cope. So we think those two things are relevant, but I understand there's something in the contradiction that you make.
I'll be following up on that in a second, but if CAMHS referrals are down 17%, people are waiting, three times as many people are waiting for referrals over a year, would that imply that CAMHS capacity has reduced during the pandemic? And is that a core issue?
I think it's hard to be definitive and support that with concrete data. And I think that's one of the themes that we make in the report about the need for more data. Interesting point, I think, that Martin Mackay makes about just that sense of capacity that exists within the system across the wide and varied partners that are contributing to service provision, and the analysis that, to see, well, the availability of services across the piece and the number of people who are working, recognising all the challenges that we know about the availability of psychiatry services, and more into the space, I suspect we'll see, but, you know, what does the future workforce look like for the provision of mental health services? But I think colleagues will be available to expand upon that, but absolutely that capacity is no doubt a factor behind some of the numbers that we put in our blog.
And just a second question for you. Looking at paragraph 13, you refer to geography matters too. How do you make that linkage when you've got NHS Grampian, who over the three-year period has significantly increased their capacity, and even NHS Tayside, from a low level, has made some significant improvements? And, you know, these are a couple of NHS boards that have been on a naughty step in the past. How does that link? You seem to be implying, by saying geography matters and so forth, that it's more difficult if you've got a spread population to be effective, and yet Grampian, and to a lesser extent Tayside, have a spread population.
So we recognise, I think what we set out in the exhibit is probably just one factor around wait times, and we've touched on already this morning the progress that Grampian has made and the exploration behind some of the factors, and also that Tayside similarly has made progress. I think we'd also note, and government colleagues may wish to comment further on this, that that's not a universal picture, that there are still some boards and areas in Scotland that aren't experiencing that level of progress. And we know that, I think, there's 7 health boards in Scotland who are receiving additional support for services to generate some of the improvements that are necessary. I think it's a point of equity, I think, that you're making, Mr. Beattie, about that really, regardless of, you know, where somebody lives in Scotland, and again, very interested to hear Alex Cumming's contribution about the number of minutes away from services, that really regardless of where you live in the country, that your access to services, whether it's direct, face-to-face, use of technology, should all be played into that people can get the right level of service when they need it, where they need it, in a truly equitable basis. But there are clearly factors in geography and worth further exploration beyond today's discussion.
Okay, so we've established that CAM's referrals have dropped 17%, and the suggestion is that it's a result of possibly school closures and limited access to GPs, rather than an actual reduction in overall demand. I would ask, to what extent do you think there's an unknown backlog of cases that CAMS aren't seeing yet? And maybe I can bring Alex Cumming in first on that one.
Yeah. Thank you, Mr. Coffey. To be honest, I think I would only be speaking anecdotally, and I think probably colleagues around the room might be able to give a better answer. We know that right across the board, as Dr. Morton has mentioned as well, through the pandemic, lots of different services, CAMS as well as others, had to reduce intake and had to change delivery mode. And obviously things have, in relation to a number of referrals, are starting to, I guess, recover. So we are starting to see those increased referrals. I'm afraid, apologies, I don't think I could give a concrete answer that you may be looking for. But anecdotally, it would make sense that there is going to be, as we've talked about in relation to the recovery from the pandemic, a wave of mental health problems across our communities. And therefore, it would make sense that CAMS are going to see an increase in the number of referrals as well.
Okay, maybe we can ask Caroline Amos if she has any input on this one.
Hello. Can you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you.
Sorry, apologise. I suppose the focus for us in education is on positive mental health and wellbeing. And I think that's what we've been, as schools, trying to do. It's the focus of that whole school approach, which sits within a whole systems approach, to ensure that we are considerate of the children and young people's wellbeing, and that we're working in a partnership way, in a collegiate way, in a cooperative way with the other services around us. Anecdotally too, I can see that there has been significant distress and challenge for some young people, some of the children in North Ayrshire. We can see that coming through in the use of our service, the educational psychology service, the conversations that we're having in schools with other partners and with other services and agencies. So yes, I suppose in education we're looking at it in two ways. One, how can we support those who are experiencing challenge, and how can we signpost them to other services that, if as required, but also focusing specifically on ensuring their wellbeing and making sure that the activities and the curriculum that we deliver has that focus on positivity and resilience and nurture.
Okay, perhaps Katrina Morton could come in there. It's automatic.
All right, I can speak loudly anyway. I suppose I was just going to come back to this issue of equity, and I do wonder whether part of this is about definitions. So I agree with earlier speakers that a consultation, a detailed consultation and assessment, can also be therapeutic and the start of therapy. But then we need everybody across Scotland to have that definition of start of treatment, and we can't have different definitions. On the other hand, an initial consultation may be an assessment that says this person has very, very severe anxiety and needs to see a psychologist. And definitive treatment might then be 6 months down the line if it's a 6 months wait for a psychologist. I'm just making that figure up. I have no idea what it is. So we just need standard definitions. And some of the feedback I've had from GPs from Grampian and Tayside have not been quite as optimistic as what we've heard. Grampians say waiting lists are long and patients and parents are often having to fend for themselves. I just wanted to I received a text from a GP. I just hope this is okay, just to very briefly read this. This GP is a mother and she's talking about her daughter. So the daughter is the patient and it's a GP who's given me permission to say this, share this. She says, my soon-to-be 13-year-old daughter has been on the CAMHS waiting list for over 2 years. In this time, her anxiety has progressively worsened and has become critical in the past 2 months to the extent that she can barely leave the house. She's been to school on less than 6 days since the start of term. School have been contacting CAMHS almost twice weekly, asking for her to be urgently seen. Our GP has written again, asking for her to be seen urgently, but she has no appointment. The impact on children and their families cannot be overstated. And I just want to say that because when we talk about a 2-year waiting list, that's what that means. You know, people don't get on a waiting list easily, as we've heard. It's a high bar to refer. It's a high bar to then be not rejected and then to go on a waiting list. So I just wanted to say that. Thank you.
OK. Martin, perhaps you might have some input here.
Sorry, in what context?
In the original question, actually, where I'm saying, do you think there's an unknown backload of cases that aren't yet evident?
I can speak from my experiences sitting around the National Stakeholders Group for Mental Health for Unison, and that at the start of the pandemic, the work that we were doing at national level in terms of strategic policy and delivery changed to focusing on direct impact of the pandemic and how we would have to change direction of services, its delivery services for mental health and wellbeing of the nation. And we know from not just mental health services, but from all kind of clinical services, we know the impact of trauma, and we know that the impact of trauma only begins to really show, you know, quite a way down the line, you know, 18 months, 2 years, you can start to have significant impact just beginning to show. Because during the so let's say 18 months of the pandemic, people are dealing with what they're having to deal with. And when their resilience levels disappear, the impact on them, you know, and their mental health and wellbeing starts to show. So we have been expecting what, you know, many people have called a tsunami of ill health and mental health and wellbeing. And we've seen it. We've seen it during the pandemic. We've seen the acuity, the level of ill health of admissions into hospital increasing. I know from my colleagues in community services, and it's the same across the whole of Scotland, that they're dealing with more and more cases within the remit of people who have become unwell. And what we have found, and we've got data of this nationally, that we have had more and more new admissions into caseloads and into the hospital that have never been known to services before, into mental health services. And that'll be exactly the same for CAMHS. And unfortunately those may or may not be in the waiting area of the delays and the referrals waiting lists. We know that this was coming and we know that it hasn't finished. The wave, the impact certainly of the pandemic in terms of mental health referrals and hospital admissions will continue. Most of our services are at full capacity. Most of our hospital beds are full. And that at the top end at tier 4 level, when that is full, the pressure just expands right through the rest of the system, out to our community teams, to our third service, our third sector colleagues in health and social care settings, and our staff who work in education, who are having to support children and young adults on a daily basis during the school day. And yes, it's I don't apologise for painting a bleak picture, because it's the information I have on the ground. It's what I know from my working colleagues on a daily basis in the wards and in the communities, and what I get from my colleagues in Unison branches and health boards and in other sectors and other employers across the country. We are at a significant point When I hear comment that we are now in the post-pandemic phase, that doesn't equate to how our staff feel on the ground and how they're trying to support either the patients that they're dealing with and having to treat in hospital or in the community or clients in other sectors. We're not in post anything. This is a tsunami wave that just keeps coming and isn't slowing, and it's just constant pressure. And that's why I've said already, I think that the funding that's come in, we need to look at how we use it differently to try and build the resilience and early intervention in health and wellbeing, because otherwise we're just throwing money at the same gaps in service that we all have always had, and we will not change. We don't have enough nurses, we don't have enough psychiatrists, we don't have enough psychologists, and in parts of the country we can't recruit them into remote and rural areas. Grampian, Highland, you know, are large areas across the country that have got significant difficulties in attracting staff from the core, from the central belt, for instance. But even there, we still recruit. We've got a significant retiral rate within these services, certainly within mental health. We can retire early because of our status, our pension status and our service status, and changes, you know, to pensions, etc., and the pressure within service are making people change how they're thinking, and they're going earlier than they would have planned. And that's putting significant pressure at the top end of staff. And we keep working to recruit more people in at the front end. But that's always a constant fight. So, yeah, again, apologies for
no, Martin. Time is running away from us, and but I think you are making some extremely powerful and important points, which I am pleased are now on the record and will allow us to follow some of that up. We are drawing towards the end of this session, and I would ask any panelists who want to come back in, if you could possibly keep any final remarks short. Colin, I don't know whether you've got any further.
Well, the only thing I was
lines of inquiry.
The only thing I was going to add to that was Martin quite rightly mentioned money, and money is the lifeblood of any service. The Scottish Government has earmarked £40 million for improvements to CAMHS. What should these improvements be? And maybe Alex Cumming, maybe you're the right person to ask first.
I think I would go back to some of my previous points, and I know colleagues will have lots of other ideas as well. But I think it's about how we ensure connections at referral, and I suppose connections when a young person or their family are rejected, because again, you know, it's not fair for them to kind of navigate the system themselves, and we need to support them to do that. So I think, link workers across Scotland have had such a positive impact. We know that hopefully there's going to be more mental health link worker type roles coming as part of the government commitment. But I think there also needs to be something specific attached to CAMHS to improve those connections for young people and for families as part of that. And I think basing things on Martin's point, it's about changing our focus slightly on, it's, you know, not necessarily just clinicians, experienced practitioners, yes, but it doesn't. I don't feel it necessarily has to be CAMHS that has those conversations and helps people navigate, you know, a very, very complex system, which, you know, is changing all the time. And, you know, individuals around this room are saying, oh, it's difficult to kind of keep up with the changes. So again, for the wider public, as I mentioned at the start, we just need to do more there.
Okay. Donna, do you have anything on this?
Well, I think there are a few areas where we want to focus. Obviously, some of the issues that have been raised today highlight the variation both in practice and in funding across the country. So one of the key areas for us is the implementation of the CAMHS specification in a robust and reliable way the country. Mr. Coffey also mentioned the specific issues around long waits, and there is a real need to focus on those. And there are seven NHS board areas that we're working with really intensively, where the biggest challenges are being felt at the moment. So I think that's another key area. I think improving community child and adolescent mental health services is another important area, particularly with some of the work we're doing on the expansion for 18 to 25 year olds and targeted groups for those who wish it. And then one of the other areas that the board has focused on is around crisis response in particular, so out of hours assessment, intensive and specialist CAM service, which really benefit children and young people with complex needs and their families, particularly in a home setting. So I think that would be the areas I would want to highlight.
Convener, I'm conscious of time, so maybe I'll draw to a close there.
Yeah, thank you very much. And I know a couple of other people wanted to come in on that area, but I do want to use the final few minutes we've got just to have a, as we are the Public Audit Committee, just to have a quick look at the absence of data issues which have previously been highlighted in some of the work of this committee as well as of Audit Scotland. And I know that Sharon Dowie, I think, has got a question or two on that. Sharon.
The Session 5 committee stated that the absence of basic data was a concern. I'll read some of the comments. In relation to spending on children and young people's mental health services, the numbers are so variable as not to be credible. We saw gaps and problems throughout the system in terms of how the money is accounted for, and critically in terms of what difference any of it makes to children. We have made a series of recommendations in the report, and those things need to be sharpened. We understand that boards will choose which ones they want to measure, which will make benchmarking very difficult. And it was a kind of common theme there. So we understand the response from that was that the Minister for Mental Health outlined work the Scottish Government was progressing with NHS National Services Scotland to improve the quality and scope of the data available. So considering that report is 2 years old now, I'd like to ask what extent has this work been progressed? If I could maybe ask Donna that question first.
Yes, happy to respond to that. So there has been, I'm conscious of time, there has been some progress already made, and I've highlighted a couple of areas that we have made progress on, and we're also working with Public Health Scotland, particularly on outcomes data and on some of the work around the benchmarking, but very happy to come back to the committee with a more detailed response on that because there has been quite a significant amount of work that's taken place. I think the one area that we do need to do more work on is that tracking the finance input and linking that to outcomes, and you know, I'm fairly sure that we'll be working with Audit Scotland on that over the next few months and on an ongoing basis.
Okay. Is anyone else wanting to come in?
Well, I don't know because of the time. I don't know whether anyone. I don't think anyone's indicated, but I do think as we've got the Auditor General here, it would be useful, I think, to get your reflections on where you think things are with the collection of data, not just data for data's sake, but data that tell us about the outcomes.
I think that's would be exactly our conclusion, convener, that, and recognising the point that Donna has made and the role that Public Health Scotland have taken around some of the analysis of referral rejections and why that has happened. But I think our sense would be, as we've said, not just in this context, but across a number of different themes, that the consistency, the high quality measurement analysis of data is an essential component of understanding how well public money has been spent and what the outcomes have been achieved from that. I think probably it's our sense is that we're not yet in a position to be definitive or much in the way of concrete evidence that we've moved terribly far beyond where we were in from our own audit report in 2018 and the predecessor committee's report in 2019. So progress to happen, and I think probably what, as we've heard over the course of this morning, some degree of urgency around that too.
Yeah, thank you. And I think that sense of urgency is absolutely right, because these children and young people are only that age once, and we need to get it right now. We can't come back in 5 years' time and decide we should have done things differently. We need to try everything we can do to offer them the support and their families, their support that they need. I'm going to draw this public part of our committee session today to a conclusion by thanking everybody for the very useful but also very informative evidence that you've given us, which will allow us to consider what our next steps are. I have to say that I'm really sorry that we ran out of time, and I know that some people did want to come back in, and I would simply say that if you are inclined, we would really appreciate you submitting any written evidence to us through the clerks, so that any of the points that you wanted to make that you weren't able to make at the roundtable session this morning will still be captured by the committee and will be a matter of record, and we will obviously look closely at that. I would also, again, as I think the Auditor General did, like to thank Donna Bell, I think, who gave a commitment that she would come back with some more information to us, both about the stats that were the data that was being asked for by Sharon Dowie at the end, but I think also in relation to the 29 recommendations. I think it would, we as a public audit committee, I think would find it very useful just to understand what progress is being made in the pursuance of those recommendations from the previous Audit Scotland report. So can I once again thank everybody for your endurance this morning. It's been quite a long session, but certainly I know that we as a committee have got a great deal out of it. And so I thank you very much for both your time and your energy, and clearly a good deal of preparation that you've made before coming to this morning's session. So thanks once again, and I now draw the public part of the committee's work to a close.